Thanks, Nicolas, and thanks to the organizers for organizing this very nice event. I'm really happy to be here. I'm learning a lot. So yeah, the purpose of this this talk will be to say something about the spectrum of very large graphs, and in particular to say something about those spikes that you see here in the picture, to relate this to the geometry of the graph, and in particular to the isoperimetric profile of the graph. Right? So I do not tell you from which model this was drawn. I'll tell you this in a minute. Let me just come back to some basics first. So what are we doing here? I'll consider just a finite, simple finite graph, right? As you know, it can be represented by an adjacency matrix, which completely encodes the information of the graph, right? This matrix is, of course, symmetric, so you can look at its eigenvalues, and it captures a lot of information about your graph, right? There is actually a whole branch of graph theory, which is specifically devoted to the connection between those eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and the property, the structural property of your graph. Right? Okay, so if you want to study those eigenvalues, especially as the size of the graph tends to infinity, it's a good idea, especially for probabilists, to encode this into a measure, as we have seen in the previous lecture, right? So you take the empirical spectral distribution, this object here, which is just a probability measure on the real line. Right? And the question is, how does this object look like for a typical large graph? Of course, the word typical here implicitly assumes that there is some kind of model where you draw your graph from. So let's do something very simple here. Let's take the uniform distribution over all graph on, say, 10,000 vertices. Right? It's a finite set. You can just pick one element at random and then plot the histogram of eigenvalues of that. Okay, what do you get? Well, this picture. That's a true simulation that I did. And what you see is this very nice semicircular shape. Right? It's a well-known phenomenon in random matrix theory. It dates back to the 50s, actually. It was discovered by Wigner. It's called the semicircle law. And it's much more general than what I just showed, but let me just mention this specific application. Right? If you take the Erdős-Reni model, so each edge is present independently with some probability p of n, right? If you want the graph to be uniform, just take p to be 1/2, but you can do something more general than that. And as long as this quantity here tends to infinity, right, so you want sufficiently many non-zero entries in your matrix, then you do have convergence to this semicircle shape. Right? So the convergence is now very well understood, and it's there's something remarkable about it, which is that it does not at all depend on the specific choice of your model. Right? So this is just a symmetric random matrix with IID entries up to symmetry, of course. Right? And for any such matrix, under some mild assumptions on the distribution of a single entry, you will have this kind of convergence. Right? So it's some kind of universality, which is exciting. And in the specific context of random graphs, just let me give you another example where the same semicircle law can be established. Random regular graphs, right? So instead of being independent, now the entries are extremely correlated, right? So that on every row you get the same number of ones, and on every column you get the same number of ones. This number is dn, right? The number of neighbors of a vertex. And as long as this dn tends to infinity, I mean, as long as this condition here is satisfied, then you do get exactly the same limiting shape, right? Semicircle distribution. Okay, so that's the universality picture. Let me just mention that the universality in random matrix theory is understood actually in a much stronger sense than just this fact here. Even if you zoom in inside the spectrum and look at the local statistics of the eigenvalues, you expect this not to depend too much on the model that you are considering. Okay, so that's another story. This is very well, but if you think about those two conditions, like sigma n squared going to infinity, this really forces your graph to be dense, right? You must have a lot of edges compared to the number of vertices, right? So the size of the graph becomes very, very large, but you also want the number of edges to be even larger than that, right? And not all graphs are like that, especially if you think of real-world networks, right? The internet graph, for example, is a huge graph, 10 to the 12 vertices. But if you look at a single page, say a typical single page, it only sees three or four neighbors, right? So it's extremely sparse. It's not at all this regime. So that's a natural question to ask, right? What about sparse graphs? what can you say about the spectrum of that? And this issue was actually raised by a physicist a few years ago, right, in a now celebrated paper, which called Beyond the Semicircle Law, right, where they actually give some simulations of a real-world network, scale-free network, where the spectrum is actually not at all semicircle shape. Right. So there is some need for a theory here. And you may wonder why would we care about looking at the spectrum of a complex network like Facebook or Internet? But that's actually something that is done in practice. There is in particular, a whole book on the subject by Piet van Meegem, which really explains why it's so important to look at the spectrum of a network to understand that network. And this is really important in that setting because a complex network like the Internet is something that is extremely complicated to grasp. And if you look at the spectrum, you get a simple fingerprint of that, which you can try to understand. So that was just a motivation. Let me show you a few pictures of what you get when you take a sparse graph instead of a dense graph. Right? What kind of spectrum do you see? So the analog of the previous simulation that I did was, this Erdős-Reni model. But now I choose the parameter p so small that every vertex sees only a limited number of neighbors, actually three in this case, on average. Right? So the graph looks like something like this. You probably have seen this in your courses, right? There is this nice phase transition when the average degree goes above one. You see this giant component appearing in the middle. And around that component, you see a bunch of floating small components, actually trees for most of those components, right? That's how the graph looks like. Now, if you take the spectrum of this object, you get the picture that I showed in the introduction, right? And not much is understood about this spectrum, right? In particular, you see those spikes, right? There is one at zero, one at minus one. The other seems to be, well, that's, there is some pattern of them. And if you remove them, you see this more smooth curve, which you expect to be an absolutely continuous part in the limit. But this is not been shown yet. Okay, so what if I change the model now? Let me take the other model that I've talked about, the random regular model. Again, now the degree is fixed, but I take it to be free. The graph looks like that. It's now connected. There is no floating component around. Right? If you look at the spectrum, that's something very, very smooth. Right? We understand everything about the density. There is the theoretical density. The red one is the Kesten-McKay distribution. Right? And you see that the approximation is quite good. Right? So you have those two different models, and they do not yield the same spectrum at all. Right? And what we would like to understand is, how does the geometry translate into the spectrum, and maybe vice versa? Right. And if you have seen the lectures on Schrödinger operators, maybe the intuition is that the spikes appear when you have a lot of roughness in your graph. So you expect this to be true. You expect to see a lot of spikes when your vertices have a very high variability in the degrees. And on the contrary, when you have a very regular graph like that, you expect something much smoother. But this picture is not at all rigorous yet. Okay, so let me just mention a third model of a sparse graph, which doesn't have a dense analog, so I have not spoken about it yet. But simple example of a sparse graph is just a tree, right? Take a large tree, uniformly at random on a certain vertex set. And the spectrum looks again like this Erdős-Reni spectrum, more or less, right? You see those spikes and maybe something continuous on top of that. Again, it's an open question to determine whether or not there is something else than those spikes, actually, in this model, right? So we really do not understand a lot about this. Okay. So in the dense regime, a lot of universality. In the sparse regime, it's not universal at all. You see those very different patterns, right? It's actually a good news for the engineers, right? Because if you want to understand a network through its spectrum, it's a good idea that the spectrum differs from one model to the other, right? Otherwise, you do not get a lot of information out of it. Right? Let me mention a few open questions. Right? So as you have seen in Charles' talk, it's now rigorous that a lot of sparse models have a sequence of spectral distribution that converge to a deterministic limit. I'll come back to that again in a few minutes. Now, this limit is model dependent. We do not understand a lot about it. This has been proved specifically in the three models that I have showed to you. So let me just credit the where the result was proved. And yeah, questions that we would like to type of questions that we would like to answer, especially here in this talk. Let me mention that even in the Erdős-Reni case, those questions were mentioned. Think about random matrix theory for a while. The adjacency matrix of an Erdős-Reni graph is the simplest possible random matrix that you can think about. Right? It's symmetric, Bernoullis, IIDs. So you should know everything about the limiting spectrum. Right? But again, those questions were raised in random matrix theory. For example, what is the height of the spike at zero, right? What is the dimension of the kernel of your adjacency matrix when the size of the graph is large? Where are those spikes? Right? This question was raised at a random matrix colloquium in 2010. And maybe more ambitiously, as Charles described in his lecture, right? Any measure, you can decompose it into a pure point, absolutely continuous and singular continuous part. What can you say about this decomposition? Right? Can you prove that there is or there is not each of those parts here. And even better, can you say something about the support of those components? Right? Okay, so the goal of my talk today will be to show you how to answer some of those questions using the framework that Charles presented to you yesterday. Okay, so let me just mention in one slide what this local weak convergence is all about in case you missed Charles' lecture. So this local weak convergence is just a definition of convergence for sequence of graphs. Take deterministic graphs for the moment, right? Finite deterministic graph, GN. You say that this sequence converges to some weird limiting object, this rho here. If the local structure in your graph converges, so in what sense do I mean that? Well, in any graph, you can always look at a ball of fixed radius around your favorite vertex in that graph. That's the neighborhood of the graph. Right? You'd like to understand this as the size of the graph tends to infinity, but the radius here stays fixed. Right? Now, this would be very easy to do if you only care about one specific vertex, this zero here. Right? But you'd like to do it simultaneously for all the vertices in your graph. So if you want to understand the local neighborhoods of all the vertices simultaneously, one natural thing to do, this was the beautiful idea of Benjamini and Schramm, to just take the empirical distribution of all those possible routes. Okay? And you say that your sequence of graph converges if this empirical distribution of neighborhood converges. So I'm not putting the formal setting up here, but you have seen it in Charles' lecture. Right? The limiting object is a probability distribution of a locally finite rooted graph. So it's the distribution of a random, potentially infinite rooted graph. Think of the Galton-Watson tree, for example. Right? And this describes what you would see in the limit if you choose a vertex at random in your graph and look locally around yourself. Well, here is one way to state that. Let me give you examples so that you understand better what I mean by that. So there are a lot of models for sparse graphs for real-world networks. All of them are actually bad. They are not good models for to model a graph like the internet or social network, but let me give you a reminder on some of the most classical random graph models. So the first that we have seen is the random regular graph, right? Fix a vertex set from 1 to n, and pick a graph uniformly at random among all graphs which have the property that every vertex has the same number d of neighbors. Right? If you look at a large random graph like that, and choose a vertex and look locally around this vertex, what you will see is actually something that does not contain any cycle. Why is that? Because those graphs are taken at random, and if you think about it, the probability that two of your neighbors do know each other is something quite small if the size of the graph tends to infinity. Right? And you can repeat this argument further away from the root, and you will convince yourself that the typical length of a cycle in such graph is logarithmic in n. Right. So there are many cycles in this graph, but they are so large that if you look locally around yourself, you will not see them. There are also a few short cycles in the graph, a few triangles, a few very short cycles, but they are extremely rare. So if you pick a vertex uniformly at random, there is little chance that you pick one which is a triangle. So in fact, what you will see is a tree, and because your graph is deregular, the only possibility is the irregular rooted tree, right? So this is the limit, the local weak limit of your sequence of random deregular graphs. Okay. So other interesting model, this Erdős-Reni model with edge probability that you tune, you take so small that the average degree remains constant, called discontinuity, right? Here again, the same thing, the same phenomenon occurs. Short cycles are extremely rare. Cycles typically have size logarithmic in N. So if you look at a fixed ball on the typical vertex, you will not see any cycle. Therefore, you will see a tree. But now the tree has no reason to be deregular at all. Right? The vertices are varying a lot in an Erdős-Reni model. Actually, the distribution of the degree of a single node is just a binomial with parameter n and pn. So in the limit, this converges to a Poisson in this regime. And it's not hard to see that the limit of the Erdős-Reni model is this Galton-Watson tree with a degree Poisson. Does everybody know what a Galton-Watson tree is? Yeah. Okay, so you can complexify this a bit. There have been, this model was not appropriated for real world networks because all the vertices have this Poisson distribution. So basically, they all look the same. And in real-world networks, what you would like to take into account is the fact that some of the vertices see a lot of people. Right? You have those big hubs in the internet graph or in Facebook. Right? You have certain people which are connected to a lot of other people. Of course, most of the vertices just see a small fraction of the graph, but some of them are extremely high. So you would like to allow for distribution, degree distribution, where you see more variance than in a Poisson distribution. And this can be done, actually. There are models of graph where you can decide in advance how many vertices you would like to, how many neighbors you would like to assign to every vertex. Right? So you decide in advance that vertex 1 will have 3 neighbors, while vertex 2 will have 4 neighbors. And right? You specify those numbers as you wish. Right? So you have a bunch of degrees, E1, D2, N, one for each neighbor, and then you can construct a random graph which has exactly those degrees that you specified. How do you do that? Well, you just, once you have this drawing here, you just choose uniformly at random a pairing. Right? Say you connect this one uniformly, right? Then this here. So sometimes you can create loops, sometimes you can also create multiple edges. So it's a multi-graph, not really a graph, but still that's a way to generate a random graph with a prescribed degree sequence. Right? Now, I would like to do asymptotics on that, so I have to put some assumptions here on the degrees. How do they behave as n tends to infinity? And the natural assumption is just to say that the empirical degree distribution converges. Right? So you look at this. Right? For each n, you have a sequence of degrees now. And you let n tends to infinity, but you assume that this distribution here converges to some limiting degree distribution. So it's a probability distribution on the integer. Right. You assume also that the first moment converges. And if you have those two assumptions, you get something which is called the configuration model with empirical distribution pi. Right. And the limit of this is the natural analog of the Galton-Watson tree in the Poisson case. It's just the Galton-Watson tree with degree low pi. Right. I'm cheating a bit here. It's not really the Galton-Watson. There is a small difference between the root and the other vertices. But if you have never seen this unimodular Galton-Watson tree, just think of it as the usual one. Okay. Other models of sparse graphs, you have seen this uniform random tree. Right? Pick a tree uniformly at random. Choose a vertex. Look uniformly around in a small ball around you. What will you see? Of course, you will see a tree, a random tree. The limit has been found actually long ago by Grimet, who called it the infinite skeleton tree. So let me just tell you what this nice object is. So you have an infinite line, semi-infinite line of vertices. 1, 2, 3. And then at each vertex, you have a pending tree. T1, T2, etc. And those TKs are just IID, Poisson, Galton, Watson, with mean C equals 1. Right. So they are just critical Poisson, Galton, Watson. Okay, so that's the thing that you see, the root is here. That's the root. Right. So if you pick a tree uniformly at random and sit at a vertex, look around you, you will feel like sitting here. That's what you will see locally. That's the limit. Okay. There are more sophisticated examples of real-world networks, so sophisticated models for that. Let me just mention the preferential attachment graph. Right? That's a graph that is constructed progressively. Right? Vertices come one after the other, and the vertices connect to those vertices that are already present. And they connect to them in a way that favors those vertices that already have a lot of neighbors, right? So if you enter the network and see someone who knows a lot of people, we'll have a higher tendency to attach to this guy. Right? This mechanism was created to explain the emergence of very large hubs in random graphs. Right? Okay, so this model is quite sophisticated to analyze in general. Right? There are many things that we do not know about it. But the local weak limit, we know that it exists, and that it's a certain random tree that I will not define. This was found recently. Okay, last example. Oh no, not an example, actually, just a remark that you have seen in Charles Stoke. Here, there are only a few examples, but in general, any local weak limit, not any probability measure can emerge as the limit of this Benjamin-Ishram sense. Keep in mind that those probability distributions on rooted graphs have a certain stationarity. Right? The limit sort of remembers the fact that the root was chosen uniformly at random. Right? So we'll not go into the details. You have seen them in Charles' talk. But really think of this unimodularity as some sort of stationarity of your random graph. Right? It looks the same from any vertex. That's what it means, essentially. Okay. Now, if you see this list here, one striking thing is that all the limits are trees, right? Random trees. Even if you started with graphs in the beginning, right? So you have cycles in the random graph models, but in the limit, you don't see those cycles anymore. You get random trees. Right? Those are only five models, but again, there are many, many models. Take your favorite one. It will have a local weak limit. If not, then change your model. That's not a good one. Yeah? Now, you have seen in Charles' talk that it's really true that there will be a limit at least upon taking a subsequence, right? If you have a sparse graph, sparse in the sense that this degree sequence here is uniformly integrable, then you have limits up to taking subsequences. So really, this notion of convergence is so weak that virtually any sparse graph has a limit. Right? So because of this weakness, you might think that the observables that this topology will capture will be just trivial. Right? And in fact, this is not the case. And there have been a lot of recent work that show that on the local weak limit of a sequence of graphs, you can read a lot of asymptotics of complicated parameters. Right? And one of them is this spectrum. So I will recall the result that Charles mentioned. Right? That's probably the most important slide in the talk. But again, you have already seen that. Right? If you take a sequence of graphs that converges in this very weak sense, that's enough to ensure that there will be a limit for the spectrum, the histogram of the eigenvalues of your adjacency matrix. Right? Okay. And even more is true. In fact, the limit, as you have seen, the convergence occurs in this strong Kolmogorov-Smirnov sense, which implies that the mass allocated to each atom also converges. Right? So that's something quite strong. Right? So this refinement is due to Abert, Tom, and Virac. Okay, so I did not tell you yet what this limiting object is. Right? But actually, you have seen it in a couple of lectures now. This limit is connected to the theory of the spectral theory for self-adjoint operators in infinite-dimensional Hilbert spaces. Right? For an infinite graph, you can still, under some appropriate condition, you can still define a spectral measure. Not a general spectral measure, but one for each vertex in your graph. Right? And then this limiting object is just the expectation of this spectral measure at the root of your random network. Right? So So one way to define this spectral measure for a fixed graph is like this, right? It's characterized by this Stieljust transform. You also have a moment characterization, which is certainly simpler, but I'm mentioning this one because I'll be using this one a lot afterwards. Okay, and let me just recall you that as Charles explained, in the case where graphs are unbounded, right? Poisson-Galton-Watson tree, for example, this object here is does not have bounded degrees. Then this adjacency operator is not a bounded operator, so it's not obvious that this object here exists at all, right? So this is a delicate issue. You can build some locally finite graphs, actually even trees, locally finite trees, on which this object does not exist, right? But those are pathological graphs, and in fact, thanks to this stationarity property, this unimodularity property, you can show that this will not be seen, this kind of pathological graph will not be seen by any unimodular measure. Okay, so for us, it will not be an issue at all. Okay. So theorem here really looks like a definitive answer to the question that I mentioned at the beginning, right? You want to understand the spectrum of your favorite model of a large graph, and actually this theorem gives you everything you want, right? It tells you that the spectrum, all what you want to know about your spectrum, is captured by this limiting measure, which is defined directly on the limiting object, right? And since every random graph sequence that have a limit in this sense, well, that's the end of the day, right? The thing is that, as you have seen in Charles' talks, for some limiting object here, you can do explicit computation and get exactly what this measure here is. But for random graphs like the one I've shown, there is no explicit formula. Right? You can already see it from this characterization that even this object here, to know something about it, you will need to know something about this resolvent of, think of a Galton-Watson tree, for example. You have to understand this object here, and even if you can understand this, you still only get a handle on the Stieljust transform of your measure. You still need to invert this transform to get something about this, right? So it's not at all a constructive formula in the sense that it's very hard to say something even about the atomic part or the absolutely continuous part of those objects, right? Just based on this definition. So rather than being a definitive answer to the questions that I have asked in the beginning, you should really see this theorem as a sort of starting point of a new theory, which is this theorem is a motivation for actually now building a theory of spectral analysis of unimodular random graphs. Right? So what can you say in general? Take a general unimodular random graph. What can you say about this object here? How can you relate this to the geometry of your graph? So you have seen examples in the talk of Charles of things that you can say about the continuous part of it based on some geometric properties of the graphs. I'll try to say some other things about this. This is too difficult in general, so I will focus on trees. Right? The official reason for focusing on trees is that all the models that I have showed to you in the introduction, the limit is a tree. So why? Right? I mean, it's already a good starting point to look at trees. The truth is that we really do not know how to say things about the atoms, for example, in the non-tree case. Okay. So in trees, there is a miracle that you have seen already in two lectures today. Right, if you think of a tree, you always have a recursive structure like that. Right? The tree can be decomposed into just a root and a bunch of subtrees. And if you remove the root, yeah, then the trees become disjoint. Right? So if you look at the adjacency matrix of a tree, what it means is that you have the first entry corresponds to the root here. But if you remove this, if you ignore this row and column, what you see here are just a bunch of block diagonal matrix, right? And the adjacency matrix here is just the one corresponding to the various trees. Right? That's how the adjacency matrix of T looks like. Of course, you can subtract Z, and the same is true. Now, if you want to compute the Stieljust transform of the spectral measure that you are interested in, you just need to invert this matrix. Right? But you have an explicit expression in order to invert this when the matrix is a diagonal block matrix. That's a basic exercise in linear algebra it's called Schur complement formula in the case where the tree is finite, to get this formula here. Right? So remember that this is the thing I'm looking at. I'm really willing to understand that because that's precisely what defines my spectral measure. Right? And this object here, it's an analytic function of Z. Right? This object is just given by a simple recursion like that. Right? That's true for finite trees, but you can extend it to infinite trees, as Charles explained, right? Using the resolvent formula. It's a simple exercise to do that. And from this, you immediately get a few things. For example, if you take the infinite regular tree here, right? Then all those trees are just the same, right? T1, T2, Td, and they're exactly the same as the original tree, right? So if you plug it here, what you get is a fixed point equation for this quantity, right? This should solve the equation x equals minus 1 divided by z plus dx. From this, you can solve explicitly, and that's how you get the Kesten-McKay density. Right? That's the only example where those example of a tree where this is explicit. Right? In general, for example, if you think of the Poisson-Galton-Watson tree, then it's not true anymore, of course, that those trees are the same. Right? But they are still the same in distribution, right? And they are independent. So what you get instead of a fixed point equation for a single number here, what you get is a fixed point equation for the distribution of a random number. Right? And in principle, so you can show that this fixed point equation has a unique solution. And so you get uniqueness. Right? If you can solve this equation, you know precisely what this object here is. And if you take expectation and then invert the Stieglitz transform, you get everything you want about the spectral measure. So in some sense, this equation here, if you can extract information about it, you should be able to recover completely the spectral distribution of your tree. Right? So you basically reduce the problem of understanding a complex network to a problem of just understanding a fixed point equations for random variables in complex valued random variables. Right? In principle, everything is contained in this equation here. Of course, it's hard to extract any useful information for that. So there are things that we can do, and I would like to show two things that you can extract from this equation on the spectrum of your favorite random tree. Okay. So in order to do that, let me just, since it's a school, let me just show quickly how you can get the value of the mass at any given location, the atomic mass at a location, from this Stieglitz transform, right? So suppose that you know the Stieglitz transform of your measure, you want to understand things about your measure, and all you know is this Stieglitz transform, which is the object I have been considering, right? So this is a function of the parameter z, right? Z takes values in the complex plane minus the real line. And this transform is injective, so in principle, you should be able to recover everything from it. Here is a simple way to recover the atoms, right? Take Z to be, decompose Z into a real part and imaginary part, right? And multiply everything by epsilon. And that's just an identity that you get, right? Now send epsilon to zero, right? Inside this integral here, everything tends to zero, right? There is epsilon everywhere, right? This first term, this real part here, is less than 1/2. Right? The second part, the imaginary part, is less than 1. So you have domination tends to zero, right? Except at a single point, right? When lambda equals lambda 0, then this term is simply not here, and what remains is just 1. Right? So if you do the dominated convergence theorem here, what you see is that you converge precisely to the value of the atoms. Right? So the message here is that if you understand your fixed point equation of the previous slide, which gives you this, right? if you can understand this fixed point equation as z approaches a given number on the real line, then you will understand the mass of the atom. That's the key to do that. And there is one specific location where this can be done completely explicitly. It's the case where lambda 0 is 0. Right? In that case, there is a sort of a simplification by symmetry, which helps a lot. And this allows you to recover completely the mass of the atom at 0. So that's a joint work with Charles and Marc quite a while ago. But I just wanted to show an explicit formula to you just to convince you that you can say things explicit about your spectrum, right? So take your favorite degree distribution. Remember that this Galton-Watson tree here is the limit of this general random graph model where you choose your degrees arbitrarily as long as they converge to this distribution pi. Right? Now take the generating function of your degree distribution. Right? That's the parameter of your model. Now the mass of the atom at zero is given explicitly by this minimization problem, right, in terms of the generating series of your degree distribution. Right? So that looks like a complicated formula. If you specialize it to the Erdős-Schreni model, right, remember that in the Erdős-Schreni model, the limit is the Poisson distribution. Right, so phi is quite simple for a Poisson, and you get this. Right. The size of the kernel of your adjacency matrix grows linearly with n, and the constant is just this quantity here. So this answers one of the questions that I presented in the introduction, right? This formula was actually conjectured by physicists Michel Bauer and Golinelli here. And the general question of understanding the size of the kernel of sparse random matrices was raised by Costello and Vu, who did the case where the graph is dense, right? In the dense case, they managed to study when the matrix is invertible and when it is not, so it's much stronger than this. But they asked for a formula in the sparse case. Right? So that's one of the things that you get out of this recursive distributional equations. Okay, so can you get more than that? So what I would like to present now is a more general thing which allows you to understand the mass of an atom at any location lambda. You will not have an explicit formula that's out of reach for now, but still you will have information, a lot of information on the eigenspace here, right? You have an infinite graph, think of the Galton-Watson tree. On this graph, you want to solve this eigenfunction equation and describe this eigenset, right? So if you want to do it on a finite graph, there is something nice that you can do, just a simple observation, right? Look at this set S, which is the union of all the possible supports of eigenvectors associated with the eigenvalue lambda. Right? So your graph is something large and complicated, but suppose that the eigenvectors just live on this part. Right? So that's your set S. This just means that outside this set, every eigenfunction will vanish. That's not just what it means, right? Now, if every eigenfunction vanishes outside this, then any eigenfunction must actually solve the eigenvalue equation on the restricted connected components here, right? Because it's zero everywhere else. You can as well forget about the rest of the graph and solve the equation directly on those small pieces, right? So it's a natural thing to look at this set because it allows you to reduce your big problem to a bunch of smaller problems, right? Now there is one miracle that happens for this set in the case of trees, right? Think of a finite tree. So now this big graph here is just a tree or a forest. Right? In that case, the eigenvalue equation on the restricted components here have a unique solution up to proportionality, of course. Right? So if you want to describe a general eigenfunction on a tree, that's quite easy, right? On each one of those components, there is a unique eigenfunction, if you forget about the rest of the graph, f1, f2, fk. Right? Now, a general eigenvector will have to vanish everywhere else, so it will just be a linear combination of those unique solutions on every component. Right? Except that you have constraints here. You may have nodes that are at the boundary of two components or more components, right? This has to be zero because it's outside the support S, but it has to solve the eigenvalue equation here, so you have this value here and this value here to be such that they cancel each other when you sum. Yeah. Right. So you have, it's subject to the constant that at every neighbor, right, this is the boundary of my set S, that's the set of vertices which are not in S, but that are neighbors of someone who is in S. Then at every X, you would like this to be zero, the sum to be zero. Right? And that's precisely, that's an exact description of your eigenspace in the case of a finite tree. That was a well-known, it's just a lemma in spectral graph theory. Right? That for trees, you have this nice decomposition here. Right. Now, in particular, if you want to know the dimension of your space, which is the multiplicity of the eigenvalue lambda, well, that's just the number of components minus the number of constraints that you get here. Right? So you get this nice formula for the dimension of the eigenspace. Again, that's for finite trees, so that's an easy lemma. Let me just rewrite this number of components, because it's a tree or a forest. The number of components is just the number of vertices minus the number of edges. Right? So I just rewrite it in this simple form. Okay. Now the main result that I wanted to present is the following. If you look now, instead of finite trees, at infinite trees, then there is no reason at all, a priori, that those subsets here are finite. Right? You could have eigenvectors that have an infinite support. Right? But what happens quite miraculously is that on a unimodular random tree, then almost surely the connected component of this support will be finite. So somehow, because of stationarity, the eigenfunction equation splits into finite parts, even on your infinite Galton-Watson tree. Say, right? So that was the first surprise. And from this, plus a bit of work on the Stieljus recursion that I showed, you can get the analog of this formula, but now for an infinite, for a unimodular random tree. Right? The analog of this formula is this. Right? So this is just the multiplicity of the atom lambda, right? Once you normalize by the number of vertices. And then those are the natural infinite counterparts to this. Right? Okay, so that's the general formula if you want to compute the mass of an atom at a given location. That's just given by this. Right? So there is a big cheat in this result, right? Which is that if you want to compute the mass of lambda, right, you still have to compute this set S, right? It's simple because it splits into finite components, but I did not say anything about those finite components. And actually, it's quite hard to understand the structure of these finite blocks, right? So it's not really an explicit formula, but what I want to convince you of is that you can extract a lot of information just from this formula and some simple information on your graph, in particular the isoperimetric profile of your graph. So that's the content of the next few minutes. Okay, so let me mention just one simple consequence of the previous result, right? Even on an infinite tree, understanding the mass of an atom at lambda boils down to understanding finite subgraphs, right? Your eigenfunction has to be an eigenfunction of a finite tree. So one consequence of this, which is surprising at first, is that the set of atoms of your measure cannot be anything, right? It has to be inside the set of eigenvalues of finite trees, right? Even if your sequence of graphs are not trees, right? Think of an Erdős-Reni, for example. In the limit, your eigenvalue must be an eigenvalue of a finite tree. So you have algebraic constraint on that. Charles explained this to you, right? Because the characteristic polynomial of an integer matrix is an integer polynomial with real roots and monic coefficient. You have constraint on this set, and you can actually completely explicitly describe this set. Right? This was a theorem that I got a few years ago. This set is precisely the set of totally real algebraic integers, so roots of real-rooted monic integer polynomial. So one direction is obvious, the other really says that any such number can be represented as the eigenvalue of some finite tree. Right? Okay, and because of that result, you immediately get the complete description of the spectrum of many limits that I presented to you, right? In particular, the Poisson-Galton-Watson tree, which is the limit of the Erdős-Reni model. Right? Why is that? Simply because, as Charles explained, the other inclusion is obvious for a Galton-Watson tree. Right? There is a positive probability that the Poisson-Galton-Watson tree realizes any given finite tree. So you will see eigenvalues of any finite tree in the limit. Right? And since you have this other implication, you get the precise determination of this spectrum. Right? The same is actually true for any Galton-Watson tree whose degree distribution is as full support, right? That's just the same simple argument. And as Charles explained, you don't really need to have a finite tree to realize an eigenvalue. All you need is this, thanks to the construction that he described, right? Even if you have an infinite graph here, as long as you can realize any finite tree at the root as a pending subtree here, right? This is an infinite thing, but as long as you can see any fixed tree with positive probability pending at the root, Then you can create an atom for any eigenvalue of a finite tree, and therefore you also get, say, unimodular Galton-Watson tree condition on non-extinction, right? Or this infinite skeleton tree. Right? For all those models, the pure point spectrum is completely determined. It's precisely this algebraic set. Right? And that's the maximum possible set that you can have in any unimodular random graph. Okay, can you say more than that? Yes, you can. We have not used at all here this explicit formula. Right? What I just showed just uses the first part, right? But we have not used this formula. So what can we say about this formula? Well, first of all, by unimodularity, you can set up a specific mass transport choosing well your transporting function, so that this formula that I showed rewrites into this thing here. Right? That's easy, that's just a simple rewriting. Right? The first term here is just the number of components, right? Because you divide by the size of the components, so it's really just, if you think of a finite graph, it's really just the number of components, and this will be the boundary term. Right? Okay, so this is still something that we do not understand a lot, because we don't know what these subgraphs look like, right? The component of the root shows up here, and here, and you don't know what this object is, so how to compute this thing is not clear right now. But let's put some simple assumptions, right? Suppose that the graph is somehow smooth, right? The degrees are between a small constant and a large constant, right? With the minimum degree being at least 3. Suppose that your tree is like that, right? Again, any model of a large random graph, provided you restrict your degrees to this case, you will get a limit like that. Okay, now if you have this, then take your formula, look at the sum here. Of course, the sum, you can lower bound it by this, the size of the boundary, right? The number of terms in the sum, right, divided by delta. So I still do not know anything about the size of the boundary, but in any tree with the minimum degree 3, any finite set, the boundary of any finite set must satisfy this inequality here, right? That's an easy induction on the size of the set, right? Whenever you are adding a new point to your set, you must add at least delta edges to it, so you have to have this. Right? Again, it's still problematic because I don't know what this component looks like. Right? But recall that this component has to satisfy the eigenvalue equation for my lambda, and not every tree can do that. Right? So let me bound this just by this tau lambda, which is the minimum possible size of a tree with eigenvalue lambda. Then you get something which does not depend anymore on the set that you don't want to understand here. Right? It's a completely deterministic bound. Plug this bound into this formula, and you immediately get that if you want this part here to be strictly positive, you have a constraint on this tau lambda, which is a sort of complexity of your algebraic integer. Right? Right? So in any unimodular random tree with degrees like that, you have only a finite possible list of eigenvalues that can appear, right? And those eigenvalues are those which are not too sophisticated, right? Those should be eigenvalues of small trees, right? Trees of size at most capital delta over small delta, right? So this looks like this was a surprise that this set is actually finite, right? So remember that if you look at the case where pi has infinite support, then you have a dense set of spikes everywhere at every algebraic number, right? But as soon as you restrict your degree a bit, then you get just a finite number of spikes in your spectrum, right? And actually, this set is quite small. If you take this to be at most 2, right? Just meaning that the ratio of maximum to minimum degree is at most 2, right? Then the bound says that your eigenvalue should be an eigenvalue of a tree of size 1. So actually, the only case is 0. Right? So the only possible spike is 0 if there is 1. And we have a formula to compute this explicitly. So in every tree like that, you have an explicit determination of the spectrum. Of course, if instead of 2, you are starting to allow more variance in your degree, so if you allow for 3, for example, then you are restricted to two kinds of eigenvalues, eigenvalue of the tree with one vertex and eigenvalues of tree with two vertices. And these are just minus 1 plus 1, and this is 0. You get a slightly upper slightly larger bound. Right? And so progressively, as you increase this quantity here, you get more and more eigenvalues in your list, but still it's a finite set. And note that this relies only on a very crude bound, right? I really use nothing about my tree, just information on the minimal and maximal degree. So it seems like there are much more things that you could extract from that. I have not done so yet, but I'm sure that there is things that you can say in specific models, like the Galton-Watson model, for example. Let me just mention one extension of this, right, to the isoperimetric profile. Instead of using this trivial inequality with the degree, you can replace your delta minus 2 with this constant here, the isoperimetric constant of your tree, right, which is what it is. And then you get by the same argument that your atom is bounded, your set of possible atoms is limited by this isoperimetric constant of your tree. So that allows you to sort of relax the condition that the minimum degree should be free. But note that it does not allow to relax this condition for Galton-Watson trees. Right? For Galton-Watson trees, as soon as you allow for degree 2 vertices, you will see with positive probability extremely long paths like that, right, with only degree 2 vertices. Right? And this will make your isoperimetric constant just go to 0. Right? So it does not help anymore for Galton-Watson trees, but still. There is a variant of this isoperimetric constant which works well for this to overcome this issue here. And this is the anchored isoperimetric constant. So in that case, it's the same kind of quantity, but you force your set to take also the root in it. Right? So in your infinite Galton-Watson tree with degree 2, you will have a lot of those arbitrarily long paths, but they will be quite far away from the root. If you want to get a very large path like that, you will have to go far away from the root. And since you have to take all the vertices that connect this graph to the root, you will collect a lot of boundary edges in the limit. So there is hope that this quantity is strictly positive even in the degree 2 case. And that's actually true. That's a result by Yuval and Chen in a few years ago, that Galton-Watson trees do have this anchored isoperimetric constant bounded away from zero. Right? So you plug this into this result, and you get again that for unimodular Galton-Watson trees, even if you allow for degree 2 vertices, you still get a finite possible list of atoms. Right? So that's the result that I mentioned by Yuval. Okay, so here is the final corollary that I wanted to mention. Right? Remember that we want to understand the set of atoms in the limiting spectrum of your favorite model of graphs. This graph will converge to a tree, hopefully, right? And in many cases to just the unimodular Galton-Watson tree. Suppose that your degree is bounded, right, by some constant, and then you have this nice dichotomy. Either you have leaves in the trees, or you don't. If you don't have leaves in the tree, right, so the probability that the degree is 1 is 0, then your spectrum is completely finite. On the other hand, if you allow for leaves in your Galton-Watson tree, then the atomic support is quite large. It's actually the largest possible support for a tree with this constraint here. It's just dense in this set. Right? So you have this nice dichotomy between finite and huge. Right? Okay, let me mention that this dichotomy was conjectured by Balint, Charles, and Arnab a few years ago. So that's a proof of it. Okay, again, this only uses very limited information about your graph, right? Just the isoperimetric constant, essentially. I'm sure that there are more things to extract from this formula if you restrict to specific models. Let me mention three specific open problems that can be interesting to you guys. Of course, the general question is, take a general unimodular random graph, what can you say about this, right? An even harder question would be to look at the spectral measure itself, not this average, but the random object, which is the spectral measure at the root of your random graph, and say things about that. As we have seen, this is a much, much more difficult task. But still, so can you say something about this support? That's something too ambitious, I would say, but let me give you three specific problems that are more doable, I think more reasonable. Right. Can you characterize those degree distribution for which there is no atom at all? Right. That's a simple question. There are criteria, right? As we have seen in Charles' talk, there is a result by Simon and co-author which says that if pi is sufficiently close to a Dirac mass, then you will not have any atoms. The result is much stronger than that. But that's one part. And you have also this criterion that Charles explained, which is that if you can construct a line ensemble on your unimodular tree, and which covers every vertex, then also you will have no atoms at all. But it's not clear which degree distribution satisfies this property, so it's an open question in general. And again, the formula that I gave might shed some light on this. Simple other open problem.
Just so wasn't the proof that in this case of the line ensemble you have some continuous spectrum?
Yes, you do have some continuous spectrum, but you may also have atoms in addition to that. And the question here is, can you determine those distributions for which there is no atom at all? Right.
Right. But I thought you just said if you have a line ensemble, it doesn't rule out atoms.
No. You need but there is a quantitative bond that he gave.
Yeah, yeah.
That if you can prove that there is a line ensemble that covers every vertex, so if your tree is Hamiltonian, then okay, an Hamiltonian tree would satisfy this. But which Galton-Watson trees are Hamiltonian beyond the regular trees? That's not obvious. Not clear. Okay. Simple limit. Remember this infinite skeleton tree, which is here, right? The limit of large random trees, right? You know that there are spikes everywhere. At every algebraic number, there is a spike. Is there something else? Right? Completely open. Simulation suggests that there is something else, but right. The result of Charles about trees which are with at least two ends, the result that he mentioned. This does not apply here because this skeleton tree only has one infinite, one end. Right? So the answer here is not clear. And to be even more specific, like take the Poisson Galton-Watson tree. Right? Can you say, you know that there is, when C is larger than one, you know that there is something else than the atom, but this something else could be a singular continuous or absolutely continuous. And can you say things about, say, the absolutely continuous part? Right? So you have conjectures on that by physicists, but. This is open. Okay, so I'll stop here. Thanks.
Thanks a lot for the beautiful lecture. So the second lecture will be tomorrow, right? So are there questions?
Is the limit of the preferential attachment graph, somebody know the spectrum?
No, but still it's a tree, so you can apply the general criteria that we are starting to build for trees, right? It is a tree, but apart from that, the limit is quite nasty. So. Again, even in simple cases, we cannot say much about the spectrum, so in this complicated case, I guess it will be hard.
But that would be a much nicer example for the real.
Sure.
How do you said that from simulation you guess that there is some continuous part?
Excellent condition. So it's clear that you don't want to just try to see if this is continuous or not just by looking at the histogram. But there is a nice computable thing that you can do, right? Here is a simple criterion. Suppose that your sequence converges to a limit and that this has no atom, right? It's pure point, say. This is pure point. Pure point. Then, right, up to a small fraction of the mass, say epsilon, everything will be contained in the sum of the first, say, k atoms in the limit. Right. Mm-hmm. So you can choose k large enough so that this is, say, 1 minus epsilon. Right. Then, remember that this converges, even the atoms converges. So you know that also for the atoms, this will be true. The same, exact same atoms, then this converges to this, which is at least 1 minus epsilon of the mass for n large enough. And, okay. But then it tells you that all the mass is contained in a finite number of eigenvalues, a bounded number of eigenvalues. So it tells you that the number of distinct eigenvalues is at most this number k plus epsilon n. But epsilon is arbitrarily small, so distinct eigenvalues has to be negligible with respect to the size of the graph. Right? Now, if you take the characteristic polynomial of the adjacency matrix of G, checking whether computing the number of distinct eigenvalues is something that you can do without solving for the root. Right? You just look at the greatest common divisor between characteristic polynomial and the derivative. And you can really do, and it looks like there is a fairly large proportion of distinct eigenvalues in this unimodular, in this uniform model. Seems like there is more than 0.5 n distinct eigenvalues in the tree, so it looks like there is something else, but proving it is another issue.
Any other question? If not, thanks, Justin.